Professor Mike Bruford, you're Professor of Biodiversity here at the Cardiff School of Biosciences and the Director of Frozen Ark. But what is Frozen Ark and what is your vision?
So the Frozen Ark is a biobanking charity, but the unusual thing that we biobank is the DNA and genetic material from endangered animal species. And because extinctions are happening so rapidly across the globe at the moment, more and more species are coming close to extinction. And if we don't save their genetic material before they go extinct, we'll lose it completely. And there are many examples now of species that have gone extinct before we even discovered them.
Tell me about the origin and the history of Frozen Ark.
So the Frozen Ark dates back to 2004, when it was originally founded, but its origin is much earlier than that. And it was the brainchild of a scientist called Professor Brian Clark, who was a geneticist based at the University of Nottingham. And Brian worked on endangered snail species, and particularly those living on islands. And he saw a whole group of species that he was studying in the South Pacific go extinct because of an ill-advised biological control experiment that was carried out. And it got him thinking that if I don't capture and take these animals out of the system now, they'll be gone forever. And so that initiated a whole set of conservation actions that resulted in a strong captive breeding program both at Nottingham University and the Zoological Society of London for these small snails, which are called partula snails, and rescuing them from extinction, but also saving their genetic material. And it was during this whole process that Brian realized that unless he saved their DNA, that they would be gone forever. There'd be no record of these organisms because there were no fossils or no other information, maybe in people's memories. But for a permanent record, we needed the genetic information.
And you're working with many biological institutions across the globe. Why not just one large centralized institution?
That's a very good question. There are a number of answers to that question. The first one is, if you are going to save eggs, you don't put them all in one basket. Okay, so when we're trying to conserve diversity of any kind, we tend to spread the risk. So multiple institutions will be involved. In the case of the Frozen Ark, the clear implication is that we need the facilities to freeze stuff. Everything from at minus 200 degrees for sperm and eggs through to minus 20 degrees for DNA extractions. But we don't want it all in the same place, because if something catastrophic happens, and that can just simply be a lightning strike and the generator going out, then everything's lost. So we have multiple institutions involved so that they can collect, conserve and save that material. But there's also a much wider issue here, which is that the genetic information that belongs to a country in principle should stay in that country, because it's that country's patrimony, it's birthright, it's heritage. And so we are interested in encouraging the establishment of biobanks across the globe in developed and developing countries.
But listening to you, there's got to be other organisations across the globe doing a very similar job. What's different about Frozen Ark?
I think one of the most important aspects of what's different about the Ark is that is our focus on purely on endangered species. There are other Frozen Arks out there that focus on zoos, but they're not necessarily just focusing on endangered species. That's always been our interest and our vision. But at the same time, I think the collaborative federated model that we operate, which is a big collaboration between many different institutions, is important. So what we do is we provide the advice, the guidance, the database, and the frozen facilities, and they're dotted around. So in the UK, we have them at five or six different locations, not just one location, not just in Cardiff or Nottingham. So it is a collaborative model that is basically bringing organisations such as the British Zoo community, the aquarium community, the museums, and the research labs in the institutions and the universities all together and kind of providing the infrastructure to make that all happen and make those genetic samples be safely looked after in a number of different locations and properly recorded and databased.
How does having a common database help the Frozen Ark in its conservation activities? And what are the challenges in putting that together?
Obviously, it's important that we collect and conserve genetic material for humanity's future. But we also need to use it for conservation programs now. And that is why the Frozen Ark is an active biobank. So, for example, if a zoo wants to run a breeding program, it needs to know where all of the individuals are across the world whose genetics it can bring together to maximize the population's fitness and chance of survival. And we can also store sperm and eggs, and we could use those sperm and eggs into the future to rescue genetic diversity when the population has been small for a long time, even though that individual is long dead.
What would you say are the biggest challenges to Frozen Ark? What do you need?
Well, the Frozen Ark is in a race against time. I think everybody recognises that. We're losing species very, very rapidly. We are in the sixth mass extinction. There's also a lot of issues around the institutional structures. There hasn't historically been a lot of funding for biobanking, except for humans and for things like cancer tissues and disease and other human tissues where there's a huge amount of investment. But I think the animal, non-model animal, endangered animal species biobanking activities have been a sideshow really and have not been properly invested in. So we're dealing with often antiquated infrastructure. So let's say a zoo, just a zoo anywhere, not a big one, they might have an old rusty minus 20 freezer, you know, an old freezer that they used to have in the kitchen and now is storing samples that the vets have collected. They won't have a database. It'll be written down on bits of paper and there won't be a backup. So there's all the infrastructural issues as well. So a whole variety of different challenges. And then getting all of the parties to come together and work together in a collaborative environment is in itself quite difficult. I'm not saying we've solved that, but we seem to have traction with most of these organisations and they believe us. We have a long enough history and track record in this area so that they know they will follow our guidance and collaborate.
I appreciate this is a very difficult question for a conservation biologist, but how on earth do you prioritise which species you're going to be working with?
That's a very good question. And prioritisation is a sort of almost a dirty word in conservation because it means making choices, and people don't want to make choices. Historically, in conservation, the choices that have been made have been really down to people's personal interests. So a curator will be interested in a particular group of species or a particular question or a particular region of the world and say, oh yes, I really want to work in Madagascar and I'm just going to save everything from Madagascar. But actually, it's a very good point because fundamentally, if we want the Frozen Ark to capture the world's genetic diversity, then we need to understand the world's genetic diversity in all of its breadth and then focus on keeping and retaining material from all parts of life's biodiversity. Deciding how you prioritise species has been described as playing God by some people, but I think we can bring rational science to it. And in fact, we're doing that right now, and other biobanks are doing exactly the same. We need to ensure that we have good and even representation of all animal life on Earth within biobanks, not just the charismatic organisms like the gorilla or the giant panda, but the bugs, you know, and the springtails and the earthworms as well.
Tell me about the research program that you have underway here at Cardiff University.
At the moment in Cardiff, our research program is focusing on preservation methods for material that has been collected from the field. And we're using genetic material from a variety of different species, but particularly from our otter project. And we're exposing that genetic material to environmental degradation before we freeze it to see how that affects the DNA. And we're also exposing the frozen DNA to bouts of defrosting to see what happens to that DNA as well. We all are used to having our freezers break down on us and wondering, I wonder if those sausages are going to still be edible afterwards.
Now, this is obviously cutting-edge science, but is there a way that the general public can also help?
So the Frozen Ark relies on the general public. We rely on the general public as our advocates. We have an active social media following, and that's great. And I think it's important because biobanking and biobanking of endangered species is not something that people think about very much. They go to zoos to see live animals. They don't go to zoos to see test tubes. Yet, the people who advocate for us really get the fact that we need to keep this material if we're going to be able to equip the life of the planet to evolve into the future under climate change and other scenarios.
While it is pretty obvious to me how the Frozen Ark conserves genetic material for humanity's use in the far future, how does the Frozen Ark collection actually help conserve endangered species now?
The reason why we need a connected database for the Frozen Ark is because all of our material is scattered across the globe. And in these different biobanks around the world, this material is kept in different ways, and the data are stored in different ways, sometimes on pieces of paper, sometimes on Excel spreadsheets, sometimes on the most sophisticated database you can imagine. But unless we bring them together, somebody who wants to manage the genetic material for a particular species won't be able to connect them. And so we need that connectivity in the data, and that's why we need a single database.
Now, despite all you've achieved, there's obviously a long way to go. And I just wondered if you could send out one message to the other conservation bodies and institutions, both in the UK and abroad, what would that be?
I think they have to understand and appreciate that genetic diversity is as important as species diversity and as ecosystems are. And that will require a paradigm shift in many of those organisations. So in their daily activities, when they are, for example, handling an animal in a hospital, whether they are walking around a reserve and finding something that's been killed, or even as little as a poo sample, that they should be thinking about collecting that material and maintaining it and storing it in a responsible manner and getting in touch with us. Because we think about biodiversity mainly in terms of species and ecosystems. We're not used to thinking about genetic material, but it is the most basic part of biodiversity. Without genetic diversity, future life can't evolve. It's as simple as that. So they've got to be thinking about that, and it's got to be running through their processes and their institutional protocols. And it is also something that I think is a potentially great importance to them in getting their message out, because they're conserving then all levels of biodiversity, not just species, for example.
Professor Mike Bruford, thank you.